Okay, thank you very much. The title of my talk is appearing on the screen now. And I'm going to mention about some developments from my group in Istanbul Technical University, which is composed of 20 persons, including my colleagues and PhD students and MS degree students. So this is, in fact, somehow some statistical issue at the same time, but mostly applied mathematical issue. So we are going to just consider this thing, and I'm going to mention about enhanced multivariate product representation. We named the issue in this way, and I'm going to give the details now. As you know, my name is appearing there, and I use the vote equivalent email addresses, Istanbul Technical University, and Gmail account, and my homepage can be accessed by looking that link through the website. I'm from Istanbul Technical University Informatics Institute and the Computational Science and Engineering Department, that's the departmental issue. And the name of the group of mine, which is in Istanbul Technical University, but it is not only peculiar to the members of Istanbul Technical University, there are some other colleagues and students coming from the other parts of the country. And there are some also minor collaboration with the United States sometimes from time to time, Princeton University, the University at Ann Arbor, and so on. Okay, now we are going to start with the decomposition of the matrices at first, at the beginning time, because everybody knows almost these kind of things, but they have a lot of latent issues which may lead us to get some other ideas. So look at the composition of a matrix. That matrix may have different number of rows and columns. The vectors EI and EJ are the standard unit vectors of the Cartesian spaces, where only non-zero element is one and located at the index of the vector under consideration. The coefficients, linear combination coefficients, are the element of the matrices. So this is a decomposition. And in this decomposition, the rightmost two terms make, in fact, algebra, I'm sorry, there is a transpose missing there of the rightmost term. So it is an outer product, a unit rank structure, and this is a quite natural decomposition. If you have the matrix, you can immediately write this one. Similarly, the analytical function theory dictates us that each function, each analytical function can be resolved in this way, in a complete infinite series, whose elements are the linear combination of the power functions. The power functions actually are the distances from a specific point in powers of that entity. And this linear combination completely defines the function under consideration. The linear combination coefficients, Fi's, are the ith derivative of the function under consideration divided by the ith factorial. And the all the term is evaluated at a given sum expansion point. Well, the next issue for the matrix decomposition is a little bit different. In the previous one, we have n times n. I mean the row number times column number terms in the expansion. So this may be quite high if the number of the rows and the columns are just climbing to high numbers. So it is better to get small numbers of linear combinations, small number terms, and this is done by using the spectral decomposition. However, in the spectral decomposition, you need to solve the eigenvalue problem, which is actually, which has a high computation complexity structure, depending on the quiet resolving of the matrix into its elements. And by using this issue, you can write the equation appearing there. And U, capital U, always U, is standing for a similarity transformation. Therefore, it is invertible, and the kernel in the middle part of the expression is a diagonal matrix if the equation contains squared matrices. However, in the case of the rectangular matrices, this may not, but this cannot be used in this way, and you can use some different issues, which are called the singular variable convolution. I'm going to mention a little bit later. If you consider the cases where not the matrices, but the kernels are considered, the kernel means the kernel of the univariate integral operator. So it is a bivariate function, and the bivariate function can be decomposed into these kind of structures. I mean, two functions can be used in this way. Again, there is another mistake. Sorry, I'm sorry for that. The last factor must have y, not x. Yeah, so by using this expression, you can, in principle, decompose the kernel of an integral operator, and this is another decomposition. Okay, in the case of the singular variable decomposition matrix, the matrix may not need to have a square structure. I mean, any rectangular matrix can be decomposed by using a singular variable decomposition, and depending on the nature, you need to solve again an eigenvalue problem from the symmetrized part of the singular decomposition target. And A is a rectangular matrix, capital sigma is a rectangular matrix, which is just composed of a diagonal, where only non-zero terms are just located. U and V are similarly transformations again. However, in the case of this structure, U and V, in their internal structures, are orthonormal matrices. This is another issue. Maybe it is not so widely known. However, it was just proposed by Sobol at the beginning of the 1990s. Sobol from Technical University of St. Petersburg is a statistician. And then, after the proposal of this structures, my colleague in Princeton University, Professor Herschel Rabbis, started to deal with the same issue, and then myself and my group started to get some improvements in this issue. Well, this is called four-dimensional model representation. It is the decomposition of a multivariate function to some terms, where in ascending number of multivariance will appear. I mean, you start with a constant, then the univariate components are coming, and the bivariate functions follow them, and so on. So the expansion, the decomposition, is a finite structure. It is not a series structure. However, this finiteness may not be so important in the practical cases, because if the number of the unknowns just climb about, say, that hundreds, then you are going to have a huge number of components which may be counted as infinite. For this reason, this expansion, although it is complete when you use all terms, is used by truncating them at the level of the constancy, at the level of univariance, or at most at the level of bivariance. So it is used as an approximation scheme. In the original definition of the five-dimensional model representation, the structures, in the original structures, the interval of the independent variables were 0-1 in Sobol's proposal, and there were used no weight function. I mean, unit weight function were used for each term. Professor Herschel from Princeton University just extended this issue in the following way. He added the variable flexible intervals, not only finite, but semi-infinite or infinite structures could be considered after his work. And the weight functions are imported into the issue. And this weight function may change throughout the intervals of the definition of the independent variables given here. So here, the structure given here is the Herschel-Rabbis structure. Well, if we proceed on this issue, we can take the expansion, and we can determine the expansion. However, you are going to ask me how. How you are going to get the components? Well, there are some vanishing conditions on the components proposed by Sobol, and by using them, it is possible to get each component uniquely. I am not going to give that because I am going to mention about in the enhanced multivariate product representation, which was proposed and developed by our group. Here, the general issue is given, and the multivariate function is again on the focus, and a constant term, but not alone, multiplied by some support functions, univariate support functions, is involved. Therefore, the support functions are new in this definition. These support functions can control the truncation quality of the new method when you compare it with the high-dimensional model representation. So this was the quite important step in the definition of the new method. The multivariance is enhanced by adding the support functions, and therefore we call the method enhanced multivariance products representation. It is high-dimensional model representation. It becomes just high-dimensional model representation. If you take all the support functions, SIs, just unit functions, it will become just high-dimensional model representation. However, this is most general, and this is more general than the other method, high-dimensional method. And we have just applied this issue into a lot of problem, and it could be able to get more efficiency in the numerical applications by using the truncations in the expansion. Okay, the coefficients Fi's, Fij's, are again the components of the expansion. They are called the components of the MS multivariate product representation. The interval is not just specified for just 0, 1 interval. You can use any finite, semi-infinite, or infinite type of intervals, and you can also use weight functions. Okay, to simplify the issue, we are going to focus on the two variable case. I mean, the target function will be considered as the function which has just two arguments, x1 and x2. In that case, the number of the terms in the expansion becomes just 4. And here, for simplicity and quite simple proceeding, we used u and v in the symbolism of the just support functions, and the support functions are just distinguished from each other by using different symbols, u and v. You can say that, okay, this is a row-wise structure and this is a column-wise structure in the sense of the matrix representation, if you just compare with the matrix representation. Now the problem is just to focus on this issue, and by using the bivariate EMPR, we are going to see what we can do in our next steps. Okay, in this issue, the support functions are considered, they are always considered as unit norm entities. Therefore, their square integrals are assumed to be 1. We do not use the phase function here to make the simplification for the explanation of the issue in a binomial way. Okay, the vanishing conditions to find the components F1 and F2, and all other things, we can use just these 4 equations. These are somehow some kind of orthogonality equations, and those 4 orthogonality issues must be used to uniquely determine the components of the EMPR for this case. So you need to get this information to find the components of the EMPR. Okay, now the components can be found in this way after solving the equations by using the vanishing conditions. You are going to get the EMPR itself, and then you are going to apply the vanishing conditions and unit norm conditions onto the support functions. Then the result will be uniquely in these 4 equations. So the equations, the constant term, constant component, then univariate components, and finally by the rector will be explained in the other issues. I mean, by having this genetic code, which is some kind of mean value of the original function, then you are going to plug in into the univariate functions, which have some directional means of the original function under consideration. And this directional meaning or the variances in somehow can be just used to give you all the information. Okay, now we are going to develop everything in the bilinear NPR, which is a continuous case. The target function is a continuous function, will be just transferred to the discrete case. In the discrete case, the target is not a function, bilinear function, but a matrix. In fact, the matrix elements are bivariate functions of their indices. Row and column become just independent arguments, independent variables, and then you can proceed. The only different thing will be the intervals or the domains of the indices and the so. So, by using this issue, we are going to suppose that the general term of AIG, the matrix EMPR, can be expressed in these four terms. A constant component, univariate components, which depend only row index, which depends on only column index, and bot. So these four terms will describe the matrix in this sense. This is the matrix EMPR. You can use the matrix EMPR to decompose a matrix in this way. So, again, the normality or the normalization conditions will be used, but in this case, not the integrals, only the finite sums will be appearing to get the condition. So all the elements squared will sum up to one for the normalization. Okay, the other conditions, if you look at the conditions, they are just linear equations, and in fact, they are corresponding to some orthonormality equations between the support functions, support vectors in this case, and also the unknown vectors. So these four equations can be used to get the final structure of the matrix EMPR, and the components can be fixed in this way uniquely. So four components, A0, A1, AI1, AJ1, and the remaining term can be expressed in this way. It is quite a complete analogy of the continuous case, and therefore there is nothing to do as in this case. Well, in concise notation, compact representation, matrix, which is just represented by boldface A, can be written in this way. A0 is a constant term which is multiplied by an outer product. The second and third term are themselves just outer products with the support functions, and a remainder term A1, 2 will appear in the representation. Now the question arises, okay, we get this matrix AMPR by using some support functions or support vectors, UV in this case. However, we still have another matrix, A1, 2. Is it possible to use some other kind of support vectors, not UV, but some other UVs, and then proceed to get another equality for the A1, 2? So by making chain of equations in this way, and by combining them into a single equation, it may be possible to get some kind of representation or diagonalization, or maybe tri-diagonalization condition, like in the diagonalization or tri-diagonalization of the matrix equation. Okay. Well, the concise notations for the normalizations can be given in this way. So these scalar products will be just a unit value. And the conditions, I mean the vanishing conditions, can be represented concisely by using this inner product, so the orthonormality appears obviously. Well, after all these, you can write the components more explicitly in terms of the chosen support functions and the matrix, target matrix under consideration. And as you see, the projection operators IL minus UU T and Im minus VVT appears in all three terms of the expansion. These are the projections, and this just enlarges the null spaces of the matrix, remainder matrix at the bottom line, I mean this line. So A has now a one higher left null space and one higher dimensional right space. So null space is growing. In a single step, you just enlarge the dimensionalities of the left and right null spaces. If you proceed in this way, the next step will add two dimensionality for left and right part, and we are going to get now more deeply null spaces in this case. I mean, at least two greater, it is greater than the original matrix null space dimensionality by two at the left hand side and the right hand side. So dimensionality in the null spaces will grow. What is the meaning of the dimensionality grow in the null spaces? Well, at some point, the null space will cover all the domain of the matrix under consideration. That means that the remainder term, A1, 2, at that stage, must vanish. That means that a complete chain of finite chain of structure will be obtained. Okay, I'm going to proceed now. And to this end, we define new support functions. That was the first step, the first ring of the chain under consideration. And by defining U2 and V2 as new normalized support vectors, we need to define some scalars, beta 1 and gamma 1, for further analysis. And by using these entities, it is possible to write the original equation in this way. Alpha 1 is a scalar, another scalar, another scalar. There are three outer, different outer products with orthogonal components and the remainder term. And all U's are expressed in this way, and they are some single structures. Therefore, the computational complexity will reduce. However, the singularity will increase. So you need to have quick steps to get the result. Okay, now I am going to consider this step as the first step. We are going to take a new matrix A1 from A0. This matrix is called in this way. And the basic definitions are given here. And then it is possible to look at the remainder term, which is capitalized by A and superscripted by 1. Is denoted in the first equation here, and the new step now will contain this kind of expression by simply changing the indices. So first residual term will be related to another new residual term with again the linear combination of the some outer products with different support vectors and the components. So you can continue in this way. This just help us to proceed in this way by defining the algebraic entities and then defining the new support vectors. So remainder term A2, the new entity, and then the situation can be generalized into a recursion. J step will be related to J plus first step, and that's the general recursion of the issue. Okay, in this way, by using this recursion, then you can proceed and by defining the generalized terms, scalars alpha j plus 1, beta j plus 1, and gamma j plus 1, you can proceed and then you can define the new support vectors for the next step in this way and look at the plus line. I mean the line given here. You see, this is a projection operator. However, this projection operator is multiplied a matrix whose rank deficiency is just j plus 1. That means that in the left null space and the right null space, the dimensionality grows by j plus 1. It increases. That means that if you proceed in this way, depending on the dimensionality of the left and right hand side of the matrices, I mean the number of the rows and the number of the columns, which are denoted by here, I'm sorry. Well, here, L is the number of the rows and N is the number of the columns. Therefore, depending on which is the smaller one, this will just match zero matrix. That means that the remainder will stop to survive. It will be just zero matrix at that point. So, all these things can be gathered into a single equation, a decomposition equation, and you see it is a finite combination. But if you want to see the concise result here, that's given here. It is like a singular value decomposition. Capital U is composed of some columns which are orthogonal each other with unit lengths or norms. And V is in the same way but in other dimensionality. And sigma is a rectangular matrix which contains just diagonal entities, non-zero diagonal entities. So more explicitly talking, we can write this case in the very specific case where the row number is 4 while the column number is 6 and the resulting sigma kernel matrix is a tridiagonal matrix. Therefore, this chain of biverity entire, we call it tridiagonal matrix EMPR, and has multivariate for the representation, we call it. And just result in a tridiagonal rectangular matrix. Then you are going to ask me, okay, you did this, well, you have tridiagonal matrix representation, what is the benefit of this representation? You can use the same thing, just a single side, single diagonal, not three diagonal. By using the singular value decomposition, what is the profit coming from this issue? Here, these equations, related equations, are not iterative. They are recursive. So you are going to start from some point and then you are going to stop. It is guaranteed. But in the singular value decomposition, depending on the initial choice and depending on the matrix structure and the eigenvalue distribution, singular value distribution, the iteration may need maybe hundreds, maybe thousand number of issues. Therefore, the computational complexity is very low with the singular value decomposition. However, the price is tridiagonality. Well, who cares? You are going to truncate if you are going to use the eigenvalues, and you are going to truncate the eigenvalue structure of the kernel from left uppermost part in a square structure. You can do the same thing here. You are not going to have a diagonal truncated structure, but you are going to have a tridiagonal truncated structure. But the price is quite low. And it works very well. We have used this issue in the just image processing of the computer vision. And in that case, about just 50%, 40%, depending on the complexity of the picture under consideration, could be obtained by using this method in the decomposition of the picture under consideration. Okay, let's proceed. Well, this method, this tridiagonalization method, depends on the initial support function choice. I didn't mention about that. I said that we are going to have U and V. We are going to start from U and V. Well, what is U and what is V? It is up to us. We are going to choose them. So the problem is how to choose them at the beginning to get more proficiency in the method. If you use those things as the singular vectors of the original matrix, then the tridiagonal structure just lumps into diagonal case. So singular value decomposition is a very specific case of this application. However, it is quite expensive if you consider the iterations. Here we started with the same elements of the vectors, beginning vectors, 1, 1, 1, 1, and then normalize them. When you do that, the UI and VI can be represented in this way. Okay, this is a good method in the sense it is not a competent to the single-value decomposition. It is a very well-known issue.